has been conscious of for a time now. We're struggling all the time to try to define this reality, to define how it looks at any particular time, and to help to inform the struggle that we're engaged in so that we can end ourselves of this oppressive relationship once and for all. Many people are experiencing this in different ways. For example, this incredibly important struggle that we see happening on high school campus right here in St. Petersburg, Florida, where African young women are even denied the right to wear a headscarf. That's a part of the identity of Africans. And up until this struggle developed on that campus, many African young women were not even conscious of the significance of the headscarf or the question of how the such a garment of, could even factor into the question of freedom or anything like that. But it does, and it did. And we're seeing now African young women rushing to the fore on the high schools, and even young African men are being mobilized by this. And this becomes a reflection of a form of oppression. The denial of even cultural identity is something that's raising its head. And of course, the reason it's raising its head now is because for a long period of time, who we are culturally has not been played such an obvious role. In some ways, it's played a role, but it hasn't been something that we've quite understood. How you wear your pants, how you wear your hat, all of these things, we've seen young people in a constant state of resistance revolving around that, but it hasn't been defined in any fashion. And it's defined culturally, not because sagging is part of some kind of African culture, but what sagging is defiance of normal white colonial culture. And when whole bunches of African people, young men do this around the country, it's an assault. It's a cultural assault on the colonial norm. And that's something that can't be tolerated. And then when that cultural assault assumes consciousness and it would say that wearing this headscarf is a part of my culture as an African, then that's even a greater threat. And so it's really important how we see this crisis of imperialism is beginning to articulate itself in the lives of African people today. I want to, our study today is coming from Israele to Africa. This is a political report that was made to the Third Congress of the African People's Socialist Party and in 1990. And the political report, this obviously predates the political report that we're working with now, which comes from our sixth Congress. That's uneasy equilibrium. But all of the political reports that we've ever done attempt to sum up the conditions in the world as we are experiencing them and what that means for our struggle as a people. And the thing is that these are reports to our Congress, and the Congress itself is a really important occurrence in the struggle of our people here. And what I want to do is, I'm not going to read the introduction here, but I am going to do an excerpt from the introduction. I'm not going to read the entire thing because the excerpt from the introduction says a lot about the significance of the Congress itself, why the Congress is important. And then beyond that, we'll get into the first chapter. And I'm apologizing already for the fact that I'm going to be reading a lot. And obviously, that's not something that makes for the best experience. But anyway. We say that while the Congress is an inter-party organization, it has already had a wide impact on our movement since the party's first Congress held in Oakland, California, 1981. So this is 1990 when this political report was made to the Congress. It's responding to the first Congress that was held in 1981. which was 9 years after the founding of the party. But the party was founded at a time when the Black Liberation Movement in this country was still reeling from a serious assault by the United States government that had already killed Malcolm X, killed Martin Luther King, made a major attack on the Black Panther Party, had killed more than 30 members of the Black Panther Party in 1968 alone, had arrested more than 300 members of the Black Panther Party, had arrested me and people who were associated with the African People Socialist Party, SNCC, the movement before that. So we were, the whole movement was experiencing severe repression. And this whole concept of freedom of speech, freedom of assembly, didn't, there was no, even no pretense about it at this moment, where meetings that we were having, such as this meeting at this moment that we're having now, where it was not unusual for police to raid the meetings with their guns drawn and children sometimes in the meetings and what have you. That was common, ordinary for a long period of time. So it was, the party came into existence in 1972, but it was 1981 before we held our first Congress. And part of the reason was the political terror. Another reason for the delay in holding our Congress was our inexperience. And the fact that we have always been a party of the African working class, in fact, and not just in name. Our organizers, the people who represent the basic membership of our party, were ordinary working class people, like those people who rose up in Ferguson on Canfield Drive, like the people who we know mostly in our communities, like the people who are always assaulted because they don't wear their pants right or because they don't use good English, et cetera. That's our base. That has always been our base. So there were certain kinds of things we didn't know how to do well. And then there was the terror that we were experiencing. So it was 1981 before we had our first Congress. So we say that, and so the Congress is an inter-party organization, has already had a wide impact on our movement since the party's first Congress held in Oakland, California in 1981. For one thing, our first Congress represented several new developments within the U.S. front of the African Liberation Movement. The counterinsurgent terror, which had defeated the Black Revolution of the 60s, had shifted sufficiently that it was possible to hold a Congress. Secondly, the Congress was evidence that the African working class, whose organization and leaders bore the brunt of the counterinsurgent terror, had required a new strength and was gearing up to complete the Black Revolution of the 60s. And thirdly, the advent of the Congress challenged the spontaneity of a rudderless African liberation movement that made policy as it went along and changed policy as a matter of convenience. Now, the significance of the party's well-publicized within the context of our movement, First Congress, and the accompanying documents were such that the refusal of the All African People's Revolutionary Party, which was a campaign-based party of the African intelligentsia, to hold a Congress resulted in a split in that organization. So the Congress, even the Congress, having the Congress was really important development of the movement, and not the least of the reasons for this, again, is that it challenged that whole kind of rudderless movement for movement's sake that had no, wasn't going any place in particular, but it was out there often just fighting, and so with no direction. The Congress helped to challenge that. And it raised the question of to what end? To what end is this struggle? To what end do we have people who are parading around with guns or who were blocking highways or interstates because they were upset? In fact, it was a thing that we began to mock, this spontaneous stuff that didn't have any direction, as the angry slave syndrome, the acronym for which was ASS. You know, so you know, it's more than just being upset. Where is it we're trying to go? How do we end this situation? Does the situation, does the system itself give rise to the kind of situations that we are constantly fighting? Or is it just some policies that we upset about any given time. So if we go to the first chapter, and this is on page 3, the Black Revolution of the 60s. I'm going to try to be as efficient as I can in moving through this chapter, and we'll talk a little bit about it, or I will, as we move forward. And then we'll go into discussion upon conclusion of the chapter. And I know we don't have much time, so I'm going to work at it. The world and our party have undergone tremendous changes since the party's founding in May of 1972, and even since our first Congress in 1981, some 9 years later. When our party was founded in 1972, U.S. imperialism was on a reckless campaign of terror throughout the world in defense of world capitalism, which was being challenged by the oppressed and colonized peoples worldwide. The center of the anti-imperialist whirlwind was in Vietnam in 1972. The U.S. was bogged down in the land of the heroic Vietnamese people in an unsuccessful, brutal, and barbaric war to keep the Vietnamese people enslaved to world capitalism led by U.S. imperialism. However, while Vietnam was the focal point of the worldwide struggle against imperialism, it was not the only front on which imperialism was being forced to fight for its life. Our people were engaging in imperialism as directly represented by Portugal and Angola and Mozambique, and in occupied Zimbabwe or Rhodesia, we were fighting against the white settler representatives of imperialism. However, all these great struggles were only a continuation of an international drive for national liberation that had been escalated by the Second Imperialist War. This is a war people call World War II, which was fought by international white power and Japanese imperialists to redivide the world, the oppressed people and our resources among themselves. Prior to the 70s, white power and Japanese imperialism had been shaken by the Chinese Revolution in 1949. This was followed by the Cuban Revolution and revolutionary activity throughout Latin America. The Kenyan Land and Freedom Army, or Mau Mau, along with the independence movement of China, of Ghana and Guinea-Conakry, and the founding of the Africanist movement in occupied Azania, and the Algerian Revolution all represent a part of the growing movement to overturn a world system based on the oppression of the majority of the world's people for the benefit of a few. The struggle to contain and turn back the revolutionary struggles of the oppressed peoples had increasingly become the responsibility of the United States. This is because the United States had become the leader of world capitalism since the Second Imperialist War had left Japan and much of Europe devastated, and the U.S. in effective control or with access to much of their colonial possessions. However, the ability of the U.S. to put down the revolutionary movements of the world was being increasingly challenged by the growing resistance of the oppressed African people within domestically colonized within the bowels of the United States. Within the U.S., the struggle for African people who were brutally kidnapped and placed in colonial slavery in the Western Hemisphere since the 16th century had from the decade from the mid-50s to mid-60s assumed the defensive character of a struggle for democratic rights, referred to as the civil rights movement under the leadership of the liberal sector of the African primitive petty bourgeoisie. And let me just jump down to the bottom of the page here on page 4, because I'm going to say something about primitive petty bourgeoisie, because we use certain language and sometimes certain sectors of the middle class say you can't use that kind of language because the workers can't understand it. I understand it, they will tell us, but the workers can't understand this kind of language. And we use this kind of language just because it's scientific, and we really struggle to be as clear as we can when we make statements. And even if people don't know what it means now, people can know what it means because they have an interest in being able to interpret our reality. And so we talk about a primitive petty bourgeoisie. That's as distinguished as the petty bourgeoisie proper. When we use terms like bourgeois, petty bourgeoisie, workers, etc., we're talking about the relationship that that different social forces, classes have to production, have to each other, have to the social system itself. We talk about classes because there is a tendency in our community, as you know, when somebody does something that we think is inappropriate in terms of the relationship to white power, white people, that person can be designated as an Uncle Tom. And we say, well, that's an Uncle Tom. But the problem is you can't know who an Uncle Tom is until that person has committed an offense. And we say that there is a better way and that there are certain class forces who have particular kind of interests. Despite how they may act at any given moment, they have particular interests. And sometimes they don't know what their interests are, that what's in their best interest, and they will work against their interests. And but there are forces that are really clear about what their interests are. Like your local neighborhood petty bourgeois politician, or the guy that's got the mayor's phone number in his back top pocket or her in her purse. Usually these are people who have an interest that's separate from the vast majority of the people in our communities. And so the fact is that they benefit materially from the conditions that the majority of African people experience, because this is what makes them important to the rulers, to the ruling class. If they were like the rest of us, then they'd be treated like the rest of us and they wouldn't have any special significance. The thing that gives them significance, it gives them usually a picture in the newspaper, allows them to be on television. And for them, for many of them, that's enough. You don't have to do too much if you can get my picture in the paper, right? Or this is validating. But in most instances, they get a lot more than this. They get elected to office and that gives them significance. They get monies. There's one local politician in this city who brags about, or did brag about, that every time the Uhurus did a demonstration, he made money because the white people would give him things in order to undermine the significance of the Uhuru movement in this city. And we talk about class forces, they exist in all societies. And have existed for a long period of time. But when we talk about like bourgeoisie, what is the bourgeoisie? The bourgeoisie is the ruling class. The bourgeoisie is somebody who owns and controls the means of production. And while there may be a few Africans who own and control the means of production, they cannot properly be called the bourgeoisie. Why? Because even this sector of the African population is dependent upon what? The white bourgeoisie, the white ruling class. So they do not function as an independent social force. They are colonial and dependent social force. And we relegate these folk most of the time to what we call the primitive petty bourgeoisie. What do we mean when we say they're primitive petty bourgeoisie? We mean they're not fully develop, not fully come unto them, unto their own. But they, given an opportunity, would become the big bourgeoisie. For them, struggling against white power means something different than it does for the rest of us. For them, struggling against white power means that they will have an opportunity to take the white man's place over in the society, over the rest of us. When we talk about freedom and liberation, we want to get rid of the whole damn thing and all the oppression that affects us. So the primitive petty bourgeoisie has a total different view of freedom than the vast majority of us. That's why they, for them, being free is being more like the white man and et cetera. And sometimes sectors of the primitive petty bourgeoisie suffer seriously from alienation from themselves. Self-alienation. They are alienated from blackness, from being with black people. And for them, the highest expression of their civilized identity is to be like and act like and be with white people. For example, think about this. You have a whole sector of the African population going through a process where we're being bombed, lynch, just, you know, want to vote. Nigga want to vote, blow him up, right? Bomb him, kill him, lynch him, hang him, burn him, you know, et cetera. This was a natural kind of thing. So can you see this sector of the African population saying, I want to be free, therefore, I want to move in the neighborhood with the people who burning, lynching, and killing me? That would not be a normal response to the person being killed, bombed, etc. That would be a response by somebody who either is experiencing self-alienation and cannot see success without being white or being with white people, or somebody who sees being with white people as a means of entering into the same economic relationships that white people have, something to that effect. But the reality is that ordinary Africans clearly would be not be knocking on the door of the local lynch mob leader and saying, boss, can I move next door to you? The normal response is to get as far away as you can from this force. And this is what I'm talking about, how, you know, these class interests reflect themselves in real material ways in the lives, in the politics that are in this community. And even today, you will see sectors of the African petty bourgeoisie, middle class, who cannot talk about African people being free, cannot have a decent discussion about that, because freedom for them means being with white people, like white people, or something to that extent. They have no ability to imagine a capacity for actually African independence. Anyway, I'm on page 4 again. So we say it's a primitive petty bourgeoisie. It's an ill-formed petty bourgeoisie. Anybody ever see a movie? They made a movie. Everybody in here too is too young to remember the movie. The movie was made even before this was written. The main thing about it was a movie that was an anti-communist movement movie, really. It's about these pods that come from outer space and these little seeds, and somehow if they are in your presence and you go to sleep, when you, they'll take over and they'll look just like you, but they just act different now. They have a whole different program. They're connected to everybody else who has been affected by this situation. Nobody saw that, did you? Yeah. So, and that was an anti-communist movement, really. It was made because of the communist menace, and that if you were slack, if you weren't on your toes all the time, next thing you know, you'd be a communist, right? Something like that. And but the reality is, that's what we are afflicted by. Consciousness is the only thing that allows us to have a possession of our own thoughts, our own actions, our own politics. Otherwise, you become a Negro. Just think, if you go to think about this, you go to sleep and you wake up a Negro. What a horrible thing to occur. You know, that's what the struggle is, to wake up people, to allow Africans to have possession of our own consciousness. The consciousness not as affected by fear, because there are Africans who cannot think, who don't have the courage even to think something that white folks might not like. You know, this is real. Don't have the courage to even think about it. That's not just a little people, that's a lot of people. Because once you think it, then you're stuck, because either you're gonna have to do something, or it's gonna have to be really crushing in terms of your own morale. Anyway, I said I was gonna expedite this, and I've already lied. I shall do everything I can to fix that. So, on page 4, this struggle for democratic rights was also influenced by the Second Imperialist War, fought by imperialist bandits to redivide the world. Having come out of the war as the indisputed leader of international capitalism, the U.S. had to resolve the contradictions stemming from access to so much wealth coming to the United States, to U.S. imperialists from European and Japanese colonies. The war was fought, so what they call World War II. You know, all this hogwash. They say about fought for democracy because, you know, we had to save the Jews and this kind of stuff is nonsense. The fact of the matter is that Jews were not even allowed to come to immigrate. You're talking about immigration? Jews were not even allowed to come. There were boatloads of Jews trying to get out of Germany who were prohibited from coming to the United States and various other places. They have nothing to do with that. This war, like all the wars that preceded it, were wars to redivide the world. These wars fought by gangsters and what have you. And like Europe had been involved in colonizing African and others for a long time. The first major colony of Europe that we are familiar with is this place that we call the United States right now. And I think it's really important to recognize this. This is part of the whole process that made Europe and white people rich at the expense of other people. This land that we're on now, where you can't even find walking down the streets any place, the traditional custodians of the land, they're in concentration camps that's called reservations, those that survived. And then half of Mexico was stolen at gunpoint, 1848, Texas, California, New Mexico, Arizona, Utah, Colorado, et cetera. This was part of Mexico. You know, Trump talking about building a damn wall, you're missing the point when you just opposed to Trump building the wall. The real point is that half the damn country was stolen at gunpoint by white people who are not indigenous to this land. And so this is where these wars, this is where the political economy was consolidated that we're confronted with today. But at the end of that war that was fought among these white folks to redivide the world, because Germany had lost a lot of its quote-unquote possessions at the end of the First World War, and now at the and Germany want its possession back, and it wants to dominate the rest of the world. It wants to get everything, and so this war happened, and to redivide the world. And as a consequence of this war, Germany loses the war. Much of Europe is devastated. The economy is wiped out, brutally devastated. Two atomic bombs are dropped in Japan, Hiroshima and Nagasaki, almost and just made economic activity production impossible in these places. So where the United States, where England was the colonial power that controlled everything in India by itself, now the United States has penetrated, because of England's weakness, the United States has penetrated England economically, India rather, economically. And then other places, Nigeria, other places that the British held solely as their own possession, the United States has now penetrated. Same thing is true with French territories and others. So as a consequence of this, the United States now has coming to it. This is the war, by the way, that ended England's dominance as the center of the monetary system. The world monetary system ended there. Up until this war, England, tiny England, a barren cold rock that no intelligent person would live willingly. No, this is true. That's why they came here. That's why they're in Australia and all these other places. Nobody wanted to live there, not if they didn't have to, right? So England controlled a quarter of the world's territory. One quarter, tiny England did, and a quarter of the world's population. And this is what made England rich. You know, this is what made that rock rich and habitable. And they got rid of a lot of the excess population who came to this place, who came to Australia, who went to all these other places. You got rid of excess population, and now you bring in all kinds of gold, diamonds, resources, and niggers to work for free. And not just African people, but Indians and other people around the world. At the end of this war, up until then, England was the monetary system was located in England. At the end of the war, England devastated, France, most of Europe devastated because the war was fought there. Japan wiped out by two atomic bombs. America ends up being the most powerful country in the world. And the world monetary system is now located in the United States. So this is where you see the US power comes from. And specifically at this particular time. So now that all of these resources, raw materials that used to go to England, used to go to Germany, used to go to France, Portugal, and all these places, Belgium, now they're coming to the United States. But the United States has a problem what to do with all these resources. So let's talk about it quickly. So we say the primary contradiction that the U.S. had was the need for a greater labor force to transform the colonial raw materials into finished products. That's the problem. You got all this the stuff coming. The docks are loaded with resources, raw materials coming from every place in the world. What the hell are you going to do with it? You got to have workers to do something. So the civil rights movement was the instrument to resolve this contradiction. I know y'all like Martin Luther King and what have you, but the contradiction that white people and white power had was how to resolve the contradiction of all these resources, raw materials, and where is the labor force going to come from to change these raw materials into finished products. It marked the beginning of a new alliance between liberal imperialism and the liberal sector of the domestically colonized African primitive petty bourgeoisie. Liberal imperialism needed the alliance in order to overturn the relations of production, which kept African people trapped in a near slavery, peasant-like servitude in the South and unavailable to imperialism in the industrial centers. This form of capitalist exploitation and colonial oppression was based on the needs of labor-intensive capitalist production in the South. The Southern planter capitalists and institutions required a servile and generally ignorant, immobile labor force. The Northern industrialists needed African laborers freed up to sell their labor power to the Northern capitalists whose production was capital intensive, requiring machinery and based in factories and enormously strengthened by U.S. imperialist penetration of European and Japanese colonies. So all these resources are coming now. This is what they're looking at, how to deal with this. The liberal sector of the African primitive petty bourgeoisie was distinguished by its desire to integrate into the oppressive capitalist system, indeed by its belief that such integration was the equivalent of freedom. The liberal African petty bourgeoisie could not envision freedom coming as a consequence of the African masses making a struggle for national liberation, nor is it certain that they would have desired black liberation from white power, even were they capable of imagining such a thing. Another characteristic of the liberal sector of the domestically colonized African petty bourgeoisie is its general alienation from its own culture, especially as it is represented as African national culture. Liu, that's what you ran into when you had this administrator and this cop on the campus. They're alienated from their own blackness, from their own culture. Plus, it gives them a paycheck. The domestically colonized liberal African petty bourgeoisie saw the way to realizing its economic aims by conquest of political power through the electoral process in the South, where in many instances, Africans outnumbered North Americans or white people. To achieve this, it was necessary to wage a struggle for democracy or civil rights, which would make African participation in the electoral process possible. Remember, Africans couldn't vote in most places in the South. And so if a Negro was gonna become the mayor or the city council or any other thing, you had to have the right to vote. And that's why Reverend Chickenbone had it in his own interest and the Undertakers and all these other middle class folk to get you to vote so that they could be elected. So the civil rights movement was informed by the interests of this sector of the African petty bourgeoisie. The alliance between the liberal oppressor and the liberal oppressed was an alliance that required a limited or partial revolution. This partial revolution would result in the oppressed African working masses being able to sell their exploited labor power to the liberal bourgeoisie and would give access to electorally gain white power to the African primitive petty bourgeoisie. So everybody's getting a piece of you. So now the liberal sector of the African petty bourgeoisie can get elected if you can vote, And the liberal sector of the white ruling class can get its factories working if you can work in them. You need an education and other kind of stuff to do that, because you need at least a minimum education to work in the factories, to work in them cotton plantations, to dig the dishes and clear ditches and clear the swamps. You didn't need any education. In fact, education was bad. But now education is needed by them, by those who control the society. That's why it became a issue. Not because Lyndon Baines Johnson or Hubert Humphreys or somebody like that love black people. They love the need. They understood the need to make this economy work to their best interest, and they needed us in the factories. In the past, where did they get workers from? They got workers from Eastern Europe. But they couldn't get the workers from Eastern Europe after the Second Imperialist War because of the advent of the Soviet Union. Now, most of the countries in Hungary and Czechoslovakia, most of the people who lived in all of these places who would previously have come to the United States and work in the factories, they can't do it because they're part of the Soviet bloc. So they don't have access to workers in Eastern Europe. So they're going to get the workers from your mama and from your grandparents, et cetera, in these plantations and stuff. They needed them off the plantation. A sector did. Not all of them. Some sectors of white power needed your ass right there where you were picking cotton and doing all this other kind of stuff. But another sector needed us to be able to leave the South, go work in those factories, and to be able to work in factories that they put them here in the South. That's what it was all about. So we say the alliance... And along with the natural aspiration of the oppressed, domestically colonized African people for national liberation, this was the real political and economic basis for the civil rights movement that mobilized and gave consciousness to millions of African people throughout the United States and the world. This was the real political and economic basis for the heroic resistance of the wretched, toiling African masses of the South. This was the basis for the brutal repression by the Southern conservative and quote capitalists, whose resistance to the civil rights movement for all its anti-African ideological articulation was actually a war for the preservation of a sector of the US-based capitalist political economy and the political power which flowed from that political economy on the one hand and protected it on the other. Let's take all the mystery out of what this damn relationship was, because they trick you and they have you following somebody because this white person like you and you want to be liked by white people's economic interests that inform the entire thing, except they knew what they were fighting for and you didn't. Even you had this redneck tobacco chewing sheriff someplace in Alabama or Mississippi, even if he was too stupid to know exactly what it was fighting for, the rulers there knew, the ones who owned those plantations knew, and many of the sheriffs and everybody, they understood it too. Because they know they needed that cheap black labor, picking the cotton, doing all that other kind of work. And guess what? If African workers were not in the station that we were in, what does it mean socially to white, uneducated white, tobacco chewing, backwards, hillbilly, white people? What does it mean if you can go to school, if you can get the job, et cetera? What does it mean to him, to his children, to family, et cetera? So they have a social status. Their significance as human beings is dependent upon your being defined as inhuman. This is the thing that elevates them to a higher station in their own view and in the view of the people of the world. You with me on that? Because this is what has happened. White identity, American identity, European identity has come through as a consequence of how they have defined us. Blackness has become the equivalence of evil and dirty and bad and harmful, and whiteness is just the opposite of that. And so if they didn't have us that they could define themselves by, they'd be in trouble, because they have defined themselves based on each other. And just think about this, white people have to deal with each other all the time instead of having to mess with you. I mean, that's a hell of a thing. I mean, white people don't like that idea. So both the white liberal oppressors and the oppressed liberal African primitive petty bourgeoisie were determined to obscure the actual material basis for the struggle known as the civil rights movement and the real stakes that were involved. Both were determined to keep the masses of African people convinced that we were struggling to change the feelings of white people toward Africans, or that we were fighting for the right to live with the white oppressor nation, US North American population. Thus, a purely idealistic, ideological cover
was given to our struggle by the liberal African primitive petty bourgeoisie. We were not told that we must be committed to philosophical nonviolence because we were involved in a limited revolution designed to serve the interests of the liberal sector of our colonial oppressors, who would never support a genuine revolution of our oppressed people. Instead, we were told that such a philosophical commitment to nonviolence was morally cleansing and empowering. This is what white folks told us. They would never have funded. These are liberals who actually gave money. They sent busloads of white people into the South, et cetera. They let Martin Luther King speak at their churches and stuff like that. As long as you're talking about something that would not overturn the whole damn social system and would dig you deeper and deeper into a relationship, as long as it's about morality and we love them and we love them, we're upset because white people don't like us and they don't like me because they think I want to marry their sister. As long as that's where we are, they love that and they will fund you doing that. They will give you tons and tons of money doing that. Soros right now is funding a sector of your movement. Soros, George Soros, the billionaire white guy. Ford Foundation is funding a sector of your movement right now because it's not about overturning the system, about changing policies. But if you have a system that's based on slavery, every damn policy is going to contribute to slavery. So you can be policy changing forever. You still got the same damn system. The policy is going to be the same even if it looks different. So anyway, however, there was always an undercurrent of resistance to the philosophical idealism, tactical strategies, and political objectives of the liberal African primitive petty bourgeoisie from within the broad perimeter of the Black liberation movement. So don't let anybody believe you that nonviolence and all of this was the only philosophical attitude that was percolating throughout the struggle. I mean, people were saying, "King, you out of your mind." A lot of people were. People saying, "I'll never march like that." People were picking up their guns in different places. In fact, this King and the Southern Christian Leadership Conference used force like the Deacons for Self-Defense, Deacons for Defense, who were not visible with guns. But the point is, the only ones you could hear, because the petty bourgeois, the liberal sector of the ruling class only wanted you to hear somebody who was saying nonviolence. So that you become convinced after a while that that's your opinion as well. That's the only rational opinion you can have. You begin to think something is wrong with you because you want to go out and do to somebody something bad to somebody who just blew up a damn Sunday school and kill four babies in there. Something's wrong with you because you want to do that. And today you got people like Chris Cuomo and Don Lemon who will help you to think something is wrong with you if you want to strike back at people who are killing you. So there was always an undercurrent of resistance. And much of this resistance came from the masses of oppressed African working people who sometimes participated in the movement despite these differences, but who often refused to participate in the movement led by African liberals. In any event, it was the African workers who armed themselves and who fought back against the violence of the state and the general white population. The radical African nationalist primitive petty bourgeoisie, especially in the form of the original Nation of Islam, gave these differences with the liberal African petty bourgeoisie an ideological expression. Struggling against the philosophical idealism which blinded the masses to our own concrete material interests in political independence and economic self-determination. So there's a radical sector of the African petty bourgeoisie that we would characterize even as a patriotic to African people. But they still a petty bourgeoisie, but they were not down with the servile stance that was coming from the civil rights movement. More and more sectors of the Black liberation movement, which were nominally under the leadership of the liberal African primitive petty bourgeoisie, began to resist the basic assumptions and the direction that the oppressed liberal alliance was attempting to impose on our movement. The most important of these sectors was the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, or SNCC. SNCC was not only distinguished within the African liberation, within the liberal African petty bourgeois-led Black liberation movement by its youthful energy and physical courage. It was also distinguished by its deep connection to the masses of oppressed African toilers with whom SNCC members lived and organized, suffering the same oppressive fate with the masses that the masses suffered themselves. And I'm just saying this quickly.
this was different. SNCC was different because you had King's people, the Southern Christian Leadership Conference. First of all, NAACP was, if it could, wasn't doing anything but filing lawsuits. But King and the Southern Christian Leadership Conference made a difference because they were actually engaged in resistance, some kind of struggle. They would lead demonstrations. They would, you know, do other kinds of actions of civil disobedience. But they had a history of, they would go into a city. They would find a church that would allow them to do that. They would have King come in. King would make a speech. A lot of thousands of people come out. They would raise money. And then and Southern Christian Leadership Conference leave town. They leave town. Then the masses going to catch hell from the white folks who are upset about them participating. But SNCC was different. You had these young Africans who would go places that an ordinary movement wouldn't go. They live with the people. They didn't just go there and make a speech and split. They actually live with the people, organize the people, and they began to share the same fate that the people were experiencing on the ground in these places. So this connection with the people was the primary basis for SNCC's growing radicalization. The growing relationship that SNCC was developing with the Nation of Islam through its most influential and working class oriented revolutionary leader, Malcolm X, increasingly fused a revolutionary character unto the mass Black liberation movement, enhancing its development from a defensive movement for civil or democratic rights to an offensive movement for national liberation that was generally and broadly conscious of its aims. It's beginning to lose some of the spontaneous character. It's beginning to talk, you know, about do for self and about being our own nation, etc. The growing independent participation of the masses in the struggle against U.S. colonial white power broke all the boundaries imposed by the liberal alliance between the liberal white ruling class and the liberal African primitive petty bourgeois throughout the U.S. of North America. Spontaneous rebellions by colonized African masses was leaving their mark on the smoldering embers of city after city. And this is true. I mean, I would literally wake up in the morning and go look at the newspaper and see what city we burned during the night. This was a hell of a period. So much so that the bourgeois media stopped reporting it. They would actually literally stop because they would say that the militants are manipulating the media. Because we were learning from each other. I'm in St. Petersburg, Florida, and I can learn what was being said and how things were being done in Oakland, California, or in Brooklyn, New York, based on picking up a newspaper. Well, they fixed that. They made sure that you were not going to be able to do that anymore. The growing independent participation of the masses in the struggle against U.S. colonial white power broke all the boundaries imposed by the alliance between the liberal white ruling class and the liberal African primitive petty bourgeoisie throughout the U.S. of North America. Spontaneous rebellions by colonized African masses were leaving their mark in the smoldering embers of city after city. By 1965, rebellion occurred in the African community of Watts in Los Angeles. It was clear the liberal African petty bourgeoisie was losing its hegemonic a hold on the people. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., along with Dick Gregory, who was shot and wounded by an African resistor, was brought to Watts by the white ruling class to pacify the rebelling masses. The chief proponent and most outstanding leader of the liberal alliance, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., was booed off the speaker's platform by militant Africans. And this is at Will Rogers Park. And I was there in Watts when this went down. And I was there when Dick Gregory tried to go out and speak to the mass and tell them to be nonviolent and go home and stuff like that. And people shot him. You know, I remember, you know, in 19, because people had absolutely begun to reject this whole turn the other cheek, suffer peaceful kind of philosophy that was being promoted by these guys. In 1966, the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee raised a slogan demand for Black Power that crystallized the transformation of our movement. The Black Power demand indicated the loss of political hegemony by the liberal African petty bourgeoisie as African workers began to speak for ourselves and our own interests. And this was incredible because now King and the liberals, they've absolutely lost control of the movement. people of Black Power became the slogan in Watts. Do you know what the slogan was in Watts in 1965? You don't. It came from a popular disc jockey who used to play music, and you know, he said, "Burn, baby, burn." And he was, when he was saying "burn," you know how we talk. You know what I mean? He wasn't saying "burn anything up," but that's, you know, we're burning. You know, "burn, baby, burn." And so, but that slogan, "burn, baby, burn," became the slogan when things were really being burned in Watts. And so people were going, "burn, baby, burn," right? And that was the slogan in 1965. 1966, every time we saw action, people were saying "Black Power." Black Power, that was the slogan demand that reverberated throughout this country and much of the world. So while the liberal sector of the black, of the white capitalist, colonialist ruling class had united with the Black Liberation Movement for very limited self-serving objectives, it seems to have failed to appreciate the depth of the relationship that domestically colonized African people have to the function of US parasitic capitalist society. It could not comprehend that the social system immediately born from the slave system and the African slavery rests upon a very shaky ideological, political, and economic foundation which cannot tolerate too much political activity from the oppressed African masses. Or if the liberal bourgeoisie, like its conservative counterpart, did recognize the significance of the African population to the stability of the parasitic capitalist social system, it placed too much faith in its liberal African primitive petty bourgeois partners' ability to control the masses or to channel our political activity into a politically safe capitalist serving arena. But the fundamental relationship that our colonial oppression has to the US North American parasitic capitalist social system and society was to wreak havoc with the general political and ideological fabric of the parasitic social system and society and the oppressive state-imposed relationships within the United States prison of nations. The movement of Black, of other subject and colonial people were galvanized by the ideological, political, and organizational influence of the Black Liberation Movement. More and more of these oppressed peoples were sharing in the tactics and strategies of our movement. Before long, the US white ruling class had to contend with the heroic revolutionary national liberation movements of the Puerto Rican, Indio, Mexican, and other native people within current US borders. Movements were also ignited or stimulated within the white oppressor nation itself. These were essentially opportunistic movements, which, although sometimes clothed in revolutionary or communist rhetoric, were actually about perfecting the oppressor nation society so as to provide economic, social, political rights and benefits for white people, white workers' benefits, women's rights, homosexual rights, legalized drugs, etc. Or they were about renting control of the parasitic relationship US capitalism has with the oppressed peoples away from the white capitalists and possessing this control themselves in the name of the white workers, their version of socialism. Absolutely none of the white nationalists left was about the liberation of African, Indian, Mexican, and Native people upon whose backs the parasitic white capitalist social system and society rest, and whose liberation is a requirement for the destruction of parasitic white capitalism. Nevertheless, the opportunistic self-serving movements of white people or North Americans for their own piece of the parasitic pie became secondary distractions for the white ruling class and complicated its difficulties in achieving the domestic class peace it needed in order to be able to secure world capitalism internationally. And you got to remember, Vietnam is happening. U.S. trying to control the people in Vietnam. They're trying to control peoples in various other places around the world. They're in a big contest with the Soviet Union, ideologically and politically, about which was the best society, capitalism or socialism. And you've got, you know, the Africans who rock in the boat in a very serious way because the whole ideological foundation of capitalism rests upon our backs. The ideological foundation, the ideas of capitalism stem from slavery, stem from colonialism. It's white nationalism. It's what people refer to as racism. It's the basic ideological foundation. So, and if you shake up this foundation about black people, then you shake the whole ideological foundation of the country. So now women got questioned, white women got questioned, white homosexuals, white workers, everybody's questioning, you know, their relationship to white power. It's like at the moment, it's like one of the reasons that white people have a problem with you being an African and you calling yourself African, because if you are an African, who the hell are they? That's a question that they have to answer. If you are an African, then who the hell are they? And I have, you know, I've seen this, like how the trauma and anxiety the Black Liberation Movement has caused for white people in this country and worldwide. So the growing independent involvement of the masses of oppressed African working people, both employed and unemployed, within the Black Liberation Movement was primarily responsible for the split that developed within the liberal front of the Black Liberation Movement, as expressed by SNCC's Black Power slogan and demand, and the hysterical response to that demand by both white liberals and their African clones. Increasingly, SNCC's worldview was also reflecting the same independence from the liberals that had been assumed by the African masses. Thus, SNCC was in the vanguard of practical opposition to US imperialist aggression in Vietnam, and in solidarity with the Vietnamese and Palestinian revolution. And I want to say this, because some people think that the peace movement of the 1960s was created by white people. Well, I want to say a couple of things about that. This is one of the things that makes the Black is Bad Coalition for Social Justice, Peace, and Reparation that we're involved in significant too. In the first place, it was when SNCC told the white, because there used to be white people who were members of SNCC. SNCC told the white people to get out of SNCC and then go to the white community and organize white people, because every problem that we got in the black community, it comes from the white people. So go organize the white people. That's what you do in solidarity with us. But most white people don't want to mess with white people. And that's a little bit of truth. I mean, you go into a white community, you go into a bastion of anti-communism, anti-blackness, a whole bunch of other stuff. So they would rather stay in your community, organize you, because you're the most progressive sector of the whole population in this country. So that's one thing. But the other thing is that it was SNCC, the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. You heard, no, you didn't. But a slogan came up in terms of the US draft. One of the reasons they had to end the draft in the United States, SNCC came up, first of all, was hell no, we won't go. And he actually said, if you want to fight this war, Lyndon Baines Johnson, that was the president, or Lady Bird, who was his wife, ought to go fight that war. We ain't fighting the war for you. We're not fighting against the Vietnamese people. This is the thing that even influenced Muhammad Ali's. Ain't no Vietnamese ever called me nigger, you know, and saying that I'm not going to Vietnam to fight some yellow man for the white man who was oppressing black people here in the United States. I mean, it was a whole important kind of ideological assault, and that fracture that happened. And so the white people then, rather than go into the African white community, they discovered the war in Vietnam. Of course, the Vietnamese helped them discover the war too, because it became costly to take your ass to Vietnam to try to take those people freedom. They were sending you back in a, they were sending gift wrap. They were sending you back gift wrapped in a body bag. So white students discovered that they should be against the war. and this was, you want them to discover why they shouldn't be killing you on the streets? Take the lessons from the Vietnamese. Anyway, so moreover, the Nation of Islam, and it was SNCC who came out in solidarity with Palestinians. It was SNCC, it was Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. I mean, SNCC didn't just come out against the Vietnam War. SNCC actually caught the bus. You know, like there used to be these buses that when they, when you were drafted and you, they put you on these buses and they take you to these induction centers. SNCC would actually get on the buses with the inductees, and on one occasion got off the bus and actually knocked the captain unconscious. I mean, the SNCC was really dramatic in its resistance and opposition to what the U.S. To all of the oppression. And this is one of the things that makes SNCC endearing to a lot of young people, which is one of the reasons I had to join that organization as well. So, you know, they would disrupt, they would go into recruiting stations, military, and wreck them, you know, just wreak havoc in them, just destroy them and what have you, in the daytime while they were there. So SNCC was, had that kind of impact. And this was the vanguard of the struggle. This SNCC came out against the war in solidarity with the Palestinian people and lost all the Jewish money as a consequence of that. The Jews who were so generous to SNCC up to that point took all their money back and actually left comrades in the most dangerous places in Mississippi, more dangerous than what the Palestinians were faced in Palestine. They took that money back and left people without transportation. People had to walk everywhere to go in the most dangerous circumstances. So they united with the terror against African people if African people took our own independent stance in solidarity with the Palestinians there. So moreover, the Nation of Islam itself sharing responsibility for the growing nationalistic ideological content of the African masses was also shaken by the influence of the independent African masses who were demanding more than holier-than-thou black nationalist ideological pronouncements, insisting that the Nation of Islam leave its mosque and join the masses in their actual struggle with U.S. capitalist colonialism. And by 1964, the limitations of the Nation of Islam were being called into bold relief by the activities of the oppressed African masses. This contributed to the pressures that led to the most revolutionary sector of the Nation of Islam, that sector that was ideological closest to the aspirations of the African masses, to the African working class, to split from the Nation of Islam under the leadership of Malcolm X. The African-inspired political cauldron within the U.S. Limited the ability of U.S. imperialism to secure world capitalism from the struggles for national liberation, which had come to be the main trend in the world by the mid-60s. The open anti-colonial rebellions by African people within the United States meant U.S. military forces were not only required in Vietnam and other areas of Southeast Asia, they were now also required to defend the existence of imperialism in Baltimore, Maryland, Chicago, Illinois, Detroit, Michigan, Birmingham, Alabama, Gainesville, Florida, and numerous other cities within current borders of the United States. Additionally, North Americans, who traditionally function as a ruling class reserve force for maintaining U.S. domestic colonialism, were split by the impact of the struggles for national liberation being led by African and Vietnamese peoples. With the thrust of the African liberation movement undermining the basic ideological assumptions of world capitalism and U.S. imperialism, namely racist white supremacy, North American women, homosexuals, and youth began to challenge the legitimacy of the ideological assumptions which bound them to inferior or undesirable status within the white oppressor nation. Millions of white youth brought face to face with white society parasitism by the strength of the Black Revolution and with their own morality by the Vietnamese Revolution, participated in massive peace and anti-war movements, which together with the national liberation movements within current U.S. borders contributed to the many fronts the U.S. had to contend with and increased the urgency with which domestic class peace had to be achieved for the security of U.S. imperialist hegemony worldwide. Despite the opportunist character of the white left, the government had to also subdue this movement. The white movement was against specific policies of U.S. imperialism as it pertained to women, Vietnam, and the draft. White radicals had to be quieted to restore peace and enlist the majority of the white population to participate in the counterinsurgency against African people. And one of the things that they did with this white left was the drug thing. They worked the drug thing on us in two ways. Acid, the whole marijuana, the whole thing that the so-called hippie culture and what have you, dropout. They
really undermined a lot of the political activism in the white community among young people by putting them on drugs, LSD, and you know, make love, not war, this whole thing. And of course, they put drugs in our community too, but it wasn't LSD. And it wasn't even at the time, it wasn't even reefer so much. They dropped hard stuff on our communities. The violent suppression of the insurgent African masses was necessary for the US to secure the internal imperialist world order and to hold its position of world colonial domination. Hence, the origin of the war without terms that led to the defeat of the Black Revolution of the 60s and the character of the counterinsurgency that affects our people and our revolution today, particularly under the overt martial law brought about by U.S. imposed drugs and the U.S. war on drugs. It is impossible to say too much about the extent of the mass anti-colonial resistance of the 60s that shook the U.S. to its foundations once this resistance broke free of the liberal African primitive petty bourgeoisie. It is also impossible to say too much about the extent and depth of the brutality with which the U.S. government responded to put down the righteous insurgency. When the mass resistance of the people broke free from the liberal African petty bourgeoisie and began setting the torch to the U.S., the people had outrun the organizational capacity of the Black Liberation Movement. The people had outrun the organizational capacity of the Black Liberation Movement. The Black Power advocates had been previously tied to the nominal leadership of the liberal African primitive petty bourgeoisie and the radical African nationalist petty bourgeoisie, was essentially non-participants in the actual struggles of the people. Hence, the activity of the masses of African workers had a spontaneous character, unrelated to any political, strategical, and organizational objectives. And you should be clear on this. What I'm saying is that it was not like the Nation of Islam or even, well, sometimes SNCC was in the streets, but it was mostly just the African people who were out there in this resistance, just like in Ferguson. It wasn't the organization. There was no organization that was leading this. This was just spontaneous activity by the masses of the people. And it didn't have any political or strategical or organizational objectives. This is one of the first things that, you know, we tried to deal with going into Ferguson. Responding to the growing resistance of the masses, new military police organizations such as SWAT were created that employed special weapons and tactics against the African people. National Guardsmen and even regular U.S. military forces were used to crush rebellions throughout the U.S., usually leaving many African casualties in their wake. In Detroit, they sent in the 82nd Airborne to crush the population there. And this, all this stuff that we're hearing about the militarization of the police, like that's something new. That ain't new. I mean, they had tanks right here in the city of St. Petersburg in 1960s. So some leaders and personalities such as Malcolm X, Sammy Young Jr., and Medgar Evers were assassinated by the U.S. government or its agents. Thousands of Africans were rounded up in military sweeps during the rebellions. Others were rounded up by the U.S. military draft and sent to the battlefront in Vietnam, where the U.S. government hoped its rebelling colonial slaves would kill each other off. However, the organized resistance was growing and scrambling to give ideological and political coherence to the spontaneous activity of the domestically colonized African masses. Even in 1964, the effort by SNCC to build the Mississippi Freedom Democratic Party would prove to be a tentative, wavering, indecisive attempt to break with the liberal bourgeois-dominated Democratic Party and develop an independent political instrument for mass struggle. That wavering stance by SNCC became less so after the imperialist Democratic Party betrayed the interests of the African masses at their 1964 National Convention in Atlantic City, New Jersey, and openly united with the Mississippi State Democratic Party organization that was the leader of the lynchings and other terroristic acts directed at our people in Mississippi. Shortly thereafter, SNCC would move to organize the Lowndes County Freedom Organization in Lowndes County, Alabama. This organization would come to be known as the Black Panther Party because of its use of the Black Panther as a symbol. Organized in a majority African county in Alabama, the Black Panther Party was conscious of the goal of winning power for Black people, although mainly through the electoral process. In 1966, black militants under the leadership of Huey P. Newton in Oakland, California, would move even further to give the African anti-colonial resistance an organizational form and ideological coherence. This is when Newton formed what was first called the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense. Self-defense, the part of the name that was assumed to clearly demonstrate the break with liberal bourgeois pacifism, was later dropped because of the limitations it imposed on the definitions of the party's task. The Oakland-based Black Panthers had been greatly influenced by the political practice, the tactics and the strategy, growing internationalism and mass-based programmatic thrust of SNCC, and by the materialist analysis, internationalism, and revolutionary anti-colonial ideology of Malcolm X. The Panthers reflected the growing realization of the connection between the worldwide struggle for national liberation. In fact, the Black Panther Party represented a fusion of the independent resistance of rebelling African masses who were in many ways influenced by SNCC and the anti-colonial ideology of economic independence and revolutionary self-determination as exemplified in the unfinished philosophy of Malcolm X. The Black Panther Party would not be the only organization attempting to give leadership to the spontaneous activity of our people. Others, such as the Revolutionary Action Movement, RAM, the Republic of New Africa, the Alabama Black Liberation Front, the Malcolm X United Liberation Front of Florida, and the Hunter Militant Organization, JOMO, a forerunner of the African People's Socialist Party, were also among the efforts being made to give organization and leadership to our anti-colonial struggle. However, it was the Black Panther Party that best captured the imagination of the masses of the domestically colonized, oppressed African workers, both employed and unemployed. Nor was the Panther attraction simply based on the Panther's flair for drama, as some contend. The Black Panther Party also put forth and to some extent implemented a 10-point program that effectively concretized many of the contradictions and aspirations of the colonially dispossessed African working masses. For all practical purposes, the Black Panther Party became the revolutionary center within the United States. That program continues to be one that the liberal African petty bourgeoisie is incapable of uniting with. Its significance and power as an organizing tool of the oppressed can be seen in this excerpt. One, we want freedom. We want power to determine the destiny of our Black community. Two, we want full employment for our people. Three, we want an end to the robbery by the capitalists of our Black community. Four, we want decent housing fit for a shelter of human beings. Five, we want education for our people that exposes the true nature of this decadent American society. We want education that teaches us our true history and our role in the present day society. Six, we want all Black men to be exempt from military service. Seven, we want an immediate end to police brutality and murder of Black people. Eight, we want freedom for all Black men held in federal, state, county, and state prisons and jails. Nine, we want all Black people within, when brought to trial, to be tried in court by a jury of their peer group or people from the Black communities as defined by the Constitution of the United States. And 10, we want land, bread, housing, education, clothing, justice, and peace. And as our major political objective, a United Nations supervised plebiscite to be held throughout the Black colony in which only Black colonial subjects will be allowed to participate for the purpose of determining the will of Black people as to their national destiny. So I just want to go over this part because it deals now with the counterinsurgency, and this is something that's really important for us to understand. So I hope you'll bear with me, and I know that the monotony of my, you know, continuous reading, you know, probably is inclined to put you to sleep. But I'm hoping this part of the discussion is something that you really struggle to deal with, and this is called the counterinsurgency. It is something that affects us even today. The diverse economic interests of the U.S. white ruling class meant there would never be total unity within it concerning the treatment and utilization of the domestically colonized African population. But the white ruling class capitalist colonial state, we're not talking about the class now, we said, but the white ruling class capitalist colonialist state, the organization of violence and coercion that perpetuates the capitalist colonialist system itself, sometimes to the detriment of specific elements of the white ruling class, was determined that the Black Revolution, either as led by the African liberals or the anti-colonialists, would never get out of hand. The African liberals were no longer trusted because, should they ever decide to abandon their alliance with the liberal bourgeoisie, their influence over the highly radicalized masses made them a great threat. That's one of the things that made King a threat. You know, he was a part of the liberal sector of the African petty bourgeoisie. But he had this huge following among African people. And if he ever changed his mind, they had a problem. So the anti-colonialists were a problem because they represented clear and present danger that could lead to the destruction of U.S. white power. To prevent the growing possibility that the anti-colonialists might seize hegemony over the entire movement, the U.S. government moved to destroy SNCC and assassinated Malcolm X in 1965. However, it was too late. The ideological influence of Malcolm X had already begun to grasp millions of African people worldwide, including those within the U.S., who built the Black Panther Party and other organizations which succeeded in upstaging the leadership of the African liberals within the most dynamic, youthful, and deeply oppressed sectors of our colonized community. It was the rise of the anti-colonial organization, especially of the Black Panther Party, that gave rise to a more consolidated, concentrated program by the U.S. government to destroy our revolution. The Black Panther Party was at the center of the U.S. government's military assault on our movement. Such a program is known as counterinsurgency. And one of the more notorious counterinsurgency efforts made by the U.S. government against the Black Liberation Movement was under the Federal Bureau of Investigation, then under the direction of Director J. Edgar Hoover, and known as Counterintelligence Program, or by its acronym, COINTELPRO. COINTELPRO was formally established in 1967. While COINTELPRO goals are excerpted here, this rather antiseptic outline, despite its anti-democratic content, does not even begin to describe the terror involved with this program. This excerpt from an actual FBI document, after announcing the expansion of the program to include 41 FBI officers, laid out the following goals. One, prevent the coalition of militant Black nationalist groups. Two, prevent the rise of a messiah who could unify and electrify the militant Black nationalist movement. Three, prevent violence on the part of Black nationalist groups. Four, prevent militant Black nationalist groups and leaders from gaining respectability by discrediting them. Five, a final goal should be to prevent the long-range growth of militant Black nationalist organizations, especially among youth. This is their program. And this is, you know, you can Google COINTELPRO and you see more than that. They identify specific persons. The U.S. government, the U.S. counterinsurgency against the U.S.-based African Revolution was extensive. Several U.S. presidents and lesser political figures, from governors, senators, and local mayors, were involved, as well as various agencies and levels of the U.S. government, including federal and state legislatures. This also included the draft board, Internal Revenue Service, judges, grand juries, local military police organizations in all branches of the U.S. military, the Central Intelligence Agencies, as well as the National Security Agency. All of these were forces that were used against our movement. Every one of them. You know, Snowden, who's now in Russia talking about the revelation that came from the NSA. The NSA was working against us. The CIA was working against us. They had naval intelligence, U.S. Army intelligence. All of these forces were out there working against this movement at this time. It was an undeclared war that was being, a war without terms that was being made on the Black Liberation Movement at the time. And this thing about the draft board, because you would find that in even some of the reactionary southern cities, such as this one, they would have significant Negroes who were on the draft board. Here, a guy who had been elementary school principal, a high school principal, was on the draft board. Knew all the African young men, and their determination was to make sure as many of these African young men would go to Vietnam as possibly. One of them in the war,
They want them killing other colonial subjects and being killed by other colonial subjects to take us out of action so that we would not be available for the struggle in this country. University, college, and high school campus officials, prison wardens, and jail officials, as well as nearly all of the white media and much of the African primitive petty bourgeois-owned media became a part of the counterinsurgency against movement, along with the general white population of generally hostile North Americans or white people. This last group included religious representatives of almost every belief and denomination. And I can't overstate this. I mean, this is a struggle for freedom. There has been a determination that African people should not, without even having to have a lot of meetings and funded different sectors, programs that are designed to divert our struggle away from an actual seizure of political power and our own benefit. And it has been a part of a counterinsurgency struggle that we've been involved in, and we run into it every day right now. Even on some of the campuses, the persons, whether they may be too stupid and too, what do you call it when these narcissists, become really impressed by their own significance, they may see themselves as being all of that, but they are instruments of a counterinsurgency program to make sure that different ideas don't get dealt with. Listen, let me tell you this, because once upon a time in this country, they talked about free speech, when everybody have free speech, etc. And they would say things like that everybody say something because they believe that the ideas themselves, the war of ideas, is a great thing. It's what improves democracy. But that's not the case. Nobody talks about free speech. Now, what they talk about today is that somehow, if you're on the internet, you can catch a bug that's called radicalization, right? You radicalize. You can do self-radicalization, or you can be radicalized by some mysterious force that's out there in cyberspace. And that's what's happening with all these people who somehow join ISIS or join Al-Qaeda or join anything, is that there's this radicalization that occurs. And so they talk about this in a fashion. In fact, they do say they're involved in an ideological battle, ideological war. And more there is an inclination to make sure that certain ideas do not have access to any kind of media outlet. That's why Facebook takes your stuff down on a regular basis. They don't want certain ideas to be discussed. They can't tolerate that. There is no space. They cannot win an ideological or political struggle. They cannot win that ideological struggle. And so they make sure that they disarm a sector of the population, so there's no context. They create a phony right-wing, left-wing debate that happens between two contending sectors of the bourgeoisie, and they eliminate any real discussion that would come from somebody or some force that would contend with, the bourgeoisie overall. So the counterinsurgency also included participation by the white left in the new sector of black puppet neocolonial politicians rising up off the defeat of the Black Revolution. The counterinsurgency was brutal and terroristic, sometimes with the help of special designer laws, such as Rap Brown Law, which prohibited crossing state borders in order to incite to riot. On a local level, laws prohibiting verbal abuse to police were created in St. Petersburg, Florida. Can you imagine? They created a law called verbal abuse of the police, and they would put you in jail for saying something bad about the police. I know. On a state level, laws were passed, such as in Florida, which prohibited inciting to riot, with a criteria for arrest being the intent of the inciter, whether a riot occurred or not. Federal no-knock laws were created, which abrogated U.S. constitutional prohibition of illegal entry by police and allowed an escalation of pre-dawn police raids
some of which resulted in blatant police murder, such as that of Black Panther Party leader Fred Hampton on December 4th, 1969 in Chicago. Bobby Hutton, Samuel Napier, John Huggins, Bunchy Carter, Mark Clark, George and Jonathan Jackson, and Fred Hampton are but a few of the members of the Black Panther Party who were martyred by the U.S. colonial counterinsurgency. Martin Luther King of the Southern Christian Leadership Council, Carl Hampton of People's Party No. 2 in Houston, Texas, and Lawrence Mann, co-founder of the African People's Socialist Party in Florida, are only three more of the countless numbers of Africans murdered by the counterinsurgency in the U.S. attempt to achieve class peace within U.S. borders. Countless others were simply kidnapped from our colonially oppressed communities under the guise of law by a colonial power whose laws are designed to maintain U.S. capitalist colonialism. Community meetings were often raided by gun-wielding colonial police, terrorizing meeting attendants. Independent community programs were destroyed. Offices and materials were burned to the ground. Revolutionary newspapers were hijacked, sometimes destroyed or soiled or otherwise made unusable. And then, on the back of this extensive military attack on our movement, the U.S. government created phony revolutionary organizations, mostly white, to challenge the ideological legitimacy, political orientation, and organizational stability of the badly battered Black Revolution that had once moved J. Edgar Hoover to define it as the most serious threat to the internal security of the United States since the Civil War. The chief architect for COINTELPRO, the FBI-led aspect of the colonial counterinsurgency, was William C. Sullivan, Google Sullivan. His next job after COINTELPRO was to be the final blow on our movement, having generally succeeded in carrying out the stated goals of COINTELPRO and removing the militant independent organizations and revolutionary leaders from effective political contention, the counterinsurgency was now changed to target the whole domestically colonized people in an attempt to destroy the revolutionary impulse. On November 1988, African People's Socialist Party leader Ajimu Muafrika, testifying before the World Tribunal on Reparations for Africans in the United States, revealed Sullivan's post-colonial COINTELPRO activities and their relation to the transformation of the U.S. counterinsurgency with these words. I'm gonna say this about Ajimu. This Negro was an agent himself. He firebombed my house, my van. We haven't seen him since the day that happened, but that's another story. But the point that I'm making is the counterinsurgency was real. It was real, it was dynamic, it wasn't something to play with. In 1970, this is the part of this quote that from the presentation. In 1971, then President Richard Milhouse Nixon chose this guy, William C. Sullivan, to head up an overseas operation that would deal with so-called drug cartel or the Southeast Asian drug connection. This same guy who became the head of the international so-called police agency that was going to fight against drugs was the same guy who was responsible for the murders of Black Panther members, the murders of Black revolutionaries all across this country, and the imprisonment of some who still languish in prison today. This guy, William C. Sullivan, because he was doing such a good job putting down our movement, was promoted. He was promoted to the agency which at one time was known as the Office of Drug Abuse Law Enforcement, or ODAIL. ODAIL, which was founded in 1972. There was a whole bunch of stuff happened in 1972, including the SWAT teams, what they characterize as certain militarization of the police. Today, ODAIL is known as the Drug Enforcement Agency, the DEA. That's where it came into existence. One of the things that ODAIL was instrumental in doing, if you remember during this time, was the no-knock law, the illegal raids. They had federal agents who were going around in the Black community knocking down doors under this so-called no-knock law. They landed American ships and airplanes into these areas in Southeast Asia and transported the drugs out. In a lot of instances, these drugs ended up in the veins of some U.S. military service people who were over in Southeast Asia. But as much as 95% of the heroin of that time ended up in the streets of North America, particularly in the oppressed African colonies in our streets. This was at the end. This was when the movement had just about been wiped out in 1971-72. You see a lot of drugs coming into the community. Our leadership was murdered or locked up. There was no leadership inside the country. There are quotes that say that in some cities, such as in New York, Baltimore, and Philadelphia, the rate of heroin addiction reached epidemic levels. As many as 90%, 80% were affected. This was the year, this was the era of terror and political defeat that our party was born into, not from scratch, not as an entirely new phenomenon of the on the political scene, but as a continuation, development of that conscious revolutionary anti-colonial tendency that overturned the hegemony of the liberal African primitive petty bourgeoisie and was in turn defeated by the white capitalist colonialist ruling class state. All right, so we only have a few minutes and I will extend it if necessary because I know I read a lot. But I would like to now open it up for discussion and let's talk about it. This is the first chapter of Israelitui Africa. Translated into Zulu, it means Africa's our land. So, any discussion? Comrades. Uhuru, Kashama.
Yeah, I really appreciate the study because it's timely in my life. I'm having a lot of discussions with people about the counterinsurgency. And I think the main reason is because a lot of what we are dealing with today, you know, I guess intra-community, it directly, you know, stemming from the defeat of our movement to liberate us, you know, during the late 60s and early 70s. So this is a very great, you know, analysis and breakdown. And I haven't had the privilege of going, you know, reading through Israeli 2E Africa. So it was a good thing for me.
Good. Anyone else?
This is C. Ali.
Yes, C. Ali.
Yeah, I just want to express my appreciation for this study also. And I think it's really important to really understand this history of the Black Power movement of the 60s and our struggle. Because a lot of our young people today have absolutely not a clue as to what our struggle was. And in many cases, they've been born into, you know, a situation where they look at life and think this is the way it's supposed to be. And you know, with this study, it gives us a foundation of this is what we were doing in the 60s. And if we can do it in the 60s, we can damn sure do it today. And I really think it's important, especially for, you know, a lot of people that are in the party right now that weren't born, you know, in the 60s, but have the benefit of understanding that we were struggling and we have always struggled against slavery and colonialism.
Uhuru. Anybody else?
Got something from Facebook.
Facebook?
Yeah, William Shaffet.
Oh. What'd you say?
William Shaffet.
William Shaffet.
Shaffet. Yeah.
Okay.
Do you see a reemergence of the primitive petty bourgeoisie's liberal political agenda? And do you see a new resistance like what had taken place in Milwaukee beginning to disrupt it?
First of all, it's here. I mean, what we see in terms of the African primitive petty bourgeoisie, it was something that really consolidated itself with the defeat of the Black Revolution of the 60s. And what we saw happen is that many of the people who were opposed to the Black Power movement at the time and are now being considered representatives of Black Power today. You see them as Black elected officials, generally speaking, which is why you don't hear a single Black politician, elected official saying, feed, clothe, and house my people. That's from your local city council person all the way up to Barack Hussein Obama. So they are in place. And part of the struggle we're involved in right now is while most young people don't understand how they came into existence, it's a struggle against them. In fact, most young people, I say young, uninformed, people who are politically uninformed, see their existence as a continuation of the struggle. That's why you will see posters and things like that will show a picture of Malcolm and King and Obama as if they were all
part of a continuum, when in fact, Obama is not a consequence of Black Power, but evidence of the defeat of the Black Power movement. And that's what most of these politicians are. Now what we have is a growing consciousness among African people. And as with every movement, you see it centered first in young people, because young people are thrust in the situation of having to solve the problems of the future. And they are thrust in that situation. And you saw in Ferguson, it's the young African working class people. And I don't want anybody to ignore that, because we keep hearing this hashtags and Black Lives Matter, but it was no hashtags. They've hijacked this movement, trying to hijack this movement that started right there in Ferguson on Canfield Drive. Because the people in Canfield Drive weren't saying body cameras, they were saying kill the police. Yeah. Which is where we left off, when the Panthers were saying, what, off the pigs, right? Because the pigs were killing us. And that's what, so you had these dilettantes who came in and hijacked the movement. And so that even Obama, the president, is defending Black Lives Matter. Soros, the billionaires funding it, along with the Ford Foundation, this is a part of the process of the liberal bourgeoisie and the African petty bourgeoisie to continue dominating this movement, which is why the party, revolutionary organization, is so critical. And when we talk about, as Siali just mentioned in time, what we were doing in the 60s, the point is not so much to show what we were doing in the 60s as to be able to show the material basis for the struggle. That the basis of the struggle isn't that somebody choked this guy on Long Island. I mean, that's a reflection of a condition that's called colonialism. And they do that every place people are colonized, the same thing happens. So the party is the entity that institutionalizes the memory of the revolution. So it's not that, see, that's what we did in the 1960s. We can show the basis of what happened in the 1960s. We can show the basis of what we see happening today and how that reflects on things that's happened in the past. We represent the memory, the historical memory of the African population. And I just think it's really important for us to understand that. And we are also the advanced detachment of the African working class itself. That's the significance of that. Uhuru, let's go. Yes, sister. Hold on. Go ahead, sister.
Okay, so if another...
Speak a little louder, because so they can hear you here. Yeah. I know you talk louder than that.
If another movement is beginning or starting now, and we organize and we do everything correctly, then they would still come and implement the same laws as before or change it so that way they can always be on top of everything and controlling the population. So then how would we get past a place that's going to control everything we do and change it so that way they can always either kill us without it because the law says it now or anything like that, just like they did for the Odell law, like, mm-hmm. and the no-knock. Lost.
Yeah, they would try to do those things. Again, sister was saying that this movement that's unfolding now, they would do the same things in terms of making laws that would guarantee them the ability to control us. One thing that we are doing that's really important that people should pay attention to is that we're determined not to go back to some kind of pre-civil rights movement. We're not going to do the civil rights movement over again, which is what much of what even calls itself this dynamic, radical Black people with the policies. That's why there is an organization called International People's Democratic Uhuru Movement. That's why, so we galvanize and we make the struggle for democratic rights, but we make them, what do we say, the highest expression of democracy is what?
Self-determination.
Not integrating with white people, but self-determination. We capture all the political space. We organized with the Black is Back Coalition for Social Justice, Peace and Reparations, so that we are spreading this thing through as many other kind of organizational forces as possible, fronts as possible. And at the same time, we're doing this. What we do is broaden the base, the political and ideological base for supporting a struggle against colonialism, not racism. As long as you're fighting against racism, then you limit what your struggle is about. You limit what the world at large can do in terms of supporting and uniting with you, But if you say you're struggling against colonialism, that in and of itself means that you're struggling to be a self-governing people. We want to govern ourselves. That's what we're trying to do. And so that just changes the whole game all up and down the line. And it takes us out of this narrowly defined thing where we're just fighting inside America, but that we have a relationship with Africans and other peoples around the world. This thing is not going to be won through elections or changing laws. It's going to be won by us getting the ability to make our own law. And that's, in the final analysis, that's what we're talking about. So we're not building a movement that's trying to get them to let us do stuff. We have tactics and strategies that will disrupt their ability to the extent that we can to harm us. But finally, what we have to do is break their back. We have to defeat them, and we have to grow our own ability to be self-governing. We make our own laws. We make the laws that govern us. And that's a whole different kind of movement and a different kind of trajectory. And I know that's not the best answer for you, but if you think about it, you'll find out it is. It is the best answer. We have to have the power, not simply fight to create a situation where they will allow us to do something, but we have to have a power. If you are oppressed, it means you have an oppressor. You can't have oppressed without oppressor. If there is an oppressor, then you can't solve the problem by getting the oppressor to like you, because it's still the oppressor. It's an oppressor that smiles now, doesn't call you nigger now, calls you Miss Nigger, right? You still got an oppressor. So what has to happen is that you have to break the back of the oppressor. You got to bust it up. You got to destroy the ability of your oppressor to do what it does to you. And you have to build a movement from the ground up based on that assumption. And that's the thing that will inform everything that you do strategically and tactically. That's the conclusion that you have to come to. As long as you accept the right of somebody else to govern and control your life and determine that what kind of future your children are going to have, you will be stuck in the same place, and you'll always be trying to figure out how can we get around them doing this and that. But once you understand what the issue is, then you make your mission to destroy the ability of your oppressor to be able to oppress you. Its ability to do that has to be destroyed. And that means everything that it takes to do that.
Everything.
Sky's the limit.
Yes. I'll be there about 2:45.
Uhuru. You should mute if you're not talking. We got a few more minutes. Let's move it. And Tom, where you were going to say something?
Yeah, Comrade Uhuru.
Please mute, Comrade. Mute. Unless you...
I know it's not.
Damn. That's who? Go ahead, Tomway. Go ahead.
Yeah, Uhuru, Comrade. I want to truly appreciate this study. Something that you said earlier about when you, it's like we actually get a thought about, you know, like what's going on and what's happening to you. Now you got to do something about it, you know. Ran across this yesterday in the car with my wife, and we were talking to her aunt on the phone. She just recently retired from the Army, Command Sergeant Major. So she she got some clout, whatnot. But this woman is, she's becoming, all these thoughts are coming in her head now about what's going on with Black people. And she's saying that, you know, I've talked to my sisters, and I'm going to start joining what Bruce and Erica got going on, because, you know, this is what she's saying. I'm going to start joining what they got going on, because this, what they're saying is true. And I think about all the things that you know, the country is and everything. She still trying to protect a certain position, but, you know, I just challenge her on the question of, you know, being radical, what is radical, and things like that. And, you know, she really had no answer to it. But she's really questioning herself now. She's in a position right now where she wants to do something. She's turning her back on a lot of people that she had unity with. And yeah, I just thought that was, it just spoke to what
we see that in every aspect of our lives. You know, the people have accepted certain things because there's nobody that's challenged it. I mean, this is the way it is. And then once you come up with a rational challenge, I mean a rational challenge, I don't mean anything just like the white man is this and that, but to be able to come up with a rational challenge, a rational explanation. And that's what we have a responsibility. Name calling won't win in our own communities. It's just name calling. We have to be able to make a rational argument inside our own community. And to the extent that we do that, it's what we will learn is that this patriotism for America and whiteness is just skin deep. Mm-hmm. It's skin deep to the extent that we begin to challenge it. And this is what our responsibility is everywhere, to multiply ourselves, you know, over and over, so that every space that they have to contend with the ideas that we're talking about in our community. I'm not even talking, but once you win it in your community, you've won it. You don't have to worry about what white people think. Once African people think the right thoughts, then what white people think will be reduced to little significance. And what you will see is that white people learn to think right too, once you think right, mm-hmm. right? Uhuru. Anybody else? Uhuru.
Listen, can you say a few words on this Colin Kaepernick struggle and what maybe this new standard in this Star Spangled Banner song that they're raising in terms of the slavery issue? How should I report it?
First of all, I really think what's important, I didn't know about the new stanza they want to put in the Star Spangled Banner, but it doesn't surprise me. They'll rewrite the Bible, under certain circumstances. Well, they have rewritten the Bible. But I think what's really important that may be missed by a lot of people is the patriotism is simply loyalty to the bourgeois colonial state. That's all patriotism. You say somebody is a patriot, you mean they're loyal to the colonial white state. And that's why we say that, you can be a white nationalist, and you can be a black white nationalist, and you can be a Mexican white nationalist. You can be all these kinds of nationalists, because when you talk about a patriot, you're talking about somebody who's loyal to the colonial white state, the colonial state. And when you have power, then you create all kinds of institutionalized means by which you raise up the patriotism of the population. And the flag is one thing, the red, white, and blue. You know, I pledge allegiance to the red, white, and blue. It's the way that the white state, you know, consolidates itself, reinforces itself, and wins patriotism among the people. And the Star Spangled Banner is another thing. And what I think is really important by this young comrade, the football player, is that it's a statement of how the struggle of the people now is beginning to penetrate the popular culture. So you had Beyonce, you know, with her Black Panther imitation thing. I've forgotten the name of the other little fellow who got 15 minutes of fame at some kind of award show or something.
Jesse Williams.
But what is increasingly beginning to happen is you see that it's penetrating the popular culture, and so that's right on. Regardless of what the motives is, somebody said Beyonce ain't a revolutionary. What the hell has that got to do with anything? Of course she's not. But she knows you are moving more and more toward revolutionary consciousness, and that's the way she is trying to keep up and with what's happening. It's become a popular trend. Blackness, revolutionary, is becoming a popular trend today, and they're trying to translate that. And so now, you know, you have the football player. And people are equating him with Muhammad Ali, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And I think it's important stance that he's taken, but I think it's really important for us to understand its relationship to see the fracturing of the patriotism. He doesn't get what he's doing himself yet.
Right.
And from what I've heard, that he's making certain kinds of concessions, although I thought it's a bold statement, a bold move that he's made, and we have to explain that to him. We have to explain that to everybody else who sees it, what that means, what the stance means, what the posture means for him, you know, because, it, you know, he risked, there was a certain element of risk involved in the stance that he took in terms of, endorsements and monies and et cetera. So it was an important thing. And it's just a statement again of how the consciousness of the radicalization of the African consciousness is escalating, and also a statement of the responsibility of revolutionaries, the party, to give it some kind of character that sums it up in a way that's most advantageous for the revolution. He needs to understand what he's done. You know, and that was true with Muhammad Ali as well, by the way. You know, K Fing, do you want to say more on that? We're over. Go ahead.
Well, what I was thinking, Chairman, was I'm not sure if the vast majority of us are familiar with this the standard and the sort of thing of eminence that comes about slavery and catching runaway slaves and shit. So the only part here being is that it would be more difficult to achieve with. How can you not support this cost thing of balance? You know, and then you just put your first on other than this is right there in the damn song.
I gotcha. So the Star Spangled Banner has a stanza that talks about catching runaway slaves.
Yeah,
okay, gotcha. So, but it would be problematic even if that wasn't in there, but I agree with you. I agree with you. You know, that's just punctuates the position that you're making. Is this Uhuru?
Oh, I didn't know. So, if you see who you, I was glad you raised the whole thing about Burn Baby Burn, because in fact it's used in a cut line on the newspaper, in this issue of the newspaper. So, I mean, just that's the historical continuity you were talking about.
Uhuru.
I got a question for K-Fing. K-Fing, what was the name of that movie Chairman was talking about?
What movie are you talking about?
The body snatchers.
Body snatchers. Yeah. Anybody else? I'm gonna shut it down in a minute. Uhuru, Akile.
Yeah, sorry for
coming to rail,
but I just wanted to appreciate
You gotta speak louder so they can hear.
I just want to appreciate this.
Because you know K Fing can't hear.
Go ahead. And just going back to defining, and revolutionaries have a responsibility to define, especially like when we have these movements, these spontaneous movements erupting, and you have all these African people coming into consciousness and are trying to figure out like because they want to be mobilized and push into action, and they wind up following these spontaneous movements, and history helps us to define that these movements aren't new, that, you know, they've existed, and this is their this is their path, this is their intention, this is what they've been brought here to do, and that it's our responsibility to define those movements to all these people coming into consciousness and wanting to take action. So I just thought that was really
powerful. Uh-huh. I think that's right, and I think one of the things about the study, what it does is shows that some of the same people you're dealing with right now, dealing with, you know, 26 years ago, I think is when this was written. Right, this is written for, and you see the same political forces at work now. See the same problems that we're trying to resolve are problems that we're taking on now. But the big advantage we have now, say from that when the party was founded, the big advantage we have now is that the African workers have their own organization. Mm-hmm. African working class, we're not coming in like this. Much of the black movement of the 1960s. Was characterized by spontaneity. Even when we look at forces like SNCC and what have you, in terms of where they were going, all of that was uncertain. And we look at, that's why this whole concept of self-defense, you know, you have a right for self-defense. When you're talking about self-defense, anything, any action that the colonized take against the colonizer is self-defense. Any act that we take is self-defense. You don't have to wait for them, to shoot at you directly. They're shooting at you 24 hours a day, every way. And the poverty they impose on you, the indignities that they impose on you, the education lack thereof that they impose on you, the housing circumstances, all of that. Those are shots being fired at you that's not even characterized as violence. So any action that's taken by the oppressed is self-defense. That's why people get upset with us, because we say somebody not just like Micah Xavier Johnson, you know, who out of Dallas, who was pretty clear about what he was doing, but even somebody like Novell Mixon in Oakland, California, who shot and killed 4 cops. They said, well, how are you going to defend this guy? He was no revolutionary. No, he was colonized, damn it. He doesn't have to be conscious. He doesn't have to be, you know, a revolution. He was colonized. And therefore, when the police functioned as a military occupying force in a colonized community. So the act that this person took was an anti-colonial act of resistance. And so it's our responsibility now to define that for masses of people who saw what happened and who knew about what happened and who thinking about being tired of this stuff, you know, it's our responsibility to give a definition. And Uhuru. So somebody is running their finger across their throat, either because they're practicing suicide or they want me to end this thing. Mm-hmm. So next Sunday, let's do the second chapter in Izwe Letu. I would really hope that people would read it. And I'm hoping that, I know we're in an era now where reading it's difficult for people, you know, because you just hit a 4-minute video or something like that, and that's a substitute. But read it. Let's try to read it and talk about it. And I won't be as long-winded next Sunday, because I won't have to be. I mean, I said much of the stuff I needed to say to introduce this discussion. So I want to thank everybody, and also just remind people that if you're not in the party, you should really be asking yourself, what in the hell is wrong with me? You know, this was, you know, not a debating situation. It was an objective of, as a study, you know, to deepen our ideological and political understanding and building a revolutionary party. I want to say that, step in Kinge, so I can understand what you're signaling me to. The NPDOM convention. I know everybody here is registered for the NPDOM convention. I am going back to Ferguson, one of my most favorite places in the world. Going back to Ferguson. Going to be with 4 Feet. Going to be with Columbae. Going to be with Adisa. All those comrades there. And that's going to be the NPDOM convention. That's going to be on September 17th and 18th. Right, that's right around the corner. And there's an event here in St. Pete at the Uhura House on September 13th, I think. It is the September 13th. That is the event where we're going to talk about this mural, this horrible mural that is the 50th anniversary of my snatching this mural down and white people charging. Citizen me to 5 years in prison for taking this mural down, and now the white folks got another plan for the wall at, and I guess they're warming up another cell. And of course, really important also is on November 5th and 6th, we're going to be in Washington, D.C. With the National Black, with the Black is Black Coalition, where we'll be putting forth a National Black Political Agenda for Self-Determination. So I'm hoping people have put that on your calendar, start your little savings plan if you haven't already started it, decide what lie you're gonna tell your boss for why you ain't coming to work on those days. Go ahead and decide which relative has to die for you to go to the funeral. You know? So, I mean, these are some of the things that we have to do, And it's a splendid period, brothers and sisters and comrades, a splendid period, magnificent, just in terms of how people all around the world are engaged in resistance that is designed to overturn this horrible relationship we have with white power. And we are part of an organization that's determined that nobody else shall ever, 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 ever govern our people except ourselves again. So Sunday, again, at 8 a.m. Eastern time. Till then, Uhuru.
Uhuru.
Well.